So this is a biology paper which was done in 2021 but was meant for 2020. So this is the first page. I want to explain to you the importance of the first page of an exam. It contains the instructions and the official part where the examiner records the marks. So let's have a look at that. This is Kenya National Examination Council Certificate of Secondary Education, Biology Paper 1, that was done in 2021, but this paper was supposed to be done in 2020 because of COVID. That's why it is indicated 2021. So this is the first page of the paper, and in this page there are a few things that you need to do. This part of the page, you are supposed to write your name. For example, Jane. It is better you use a capital letter. So you say Jane Jones. So you write your index number. The index number is normally shown. There is a school code which is usually displayed on the board. Like you can say 250061, and then your index number, maybe you are 0012. So that's your index number that you assigned in school. This is a school code. You sign your paper, so put your signature and you put the date that you are taking that exam. So once you are through with that, there is a second part of this page. This part now is the instructions that you are supposed to read. So part A, write your name and index number in the spaces provided above. You have already done that. Sign and write the date of examination in the spaces provided that I have shown you. Answer all the questions in the spaces provided in this booklet. These instructions is very important because you don't carry extra writing materials. All your work you do on the that is a booklet. This paper consists of 12 printed pages, so you confirm that so that you don't start with a paper that has some missing pages. Candidates should check question paper to ascertain that all the pages are printed as indicated and no questions are missing. Candidates should answer questions in English. You don't use any other language like Sheng or Kiswahili or your mother tongue. You use English because that is what the examiner will be marking. The next part of this page is for examiner's use only, so you are not supposed to write anything here. This page is where the examiner who check your work will record the marks. For example, in question 1 you get 1, question 10 you get 2, like that, and then finally you record the grade here, or maybe you get 40, like that. So that is the first page of the paper, and it is you are given a few minutes to go through it so that you can be able to read the instructions, write your name and so on. So before you start the questions, so let us go to question number 1. This is question number 1, and we are told name the taxonomic grouping that contains individuals with most similarities. So you get 1 mark. So this is a simple question. Let's see what is the answer of this question. So this is question number 1, and you are supposed to answer all the questions in the space provided. Question 1 says name the taxonomic grouping that contain individuals with most similarities. So individuals with most similarities are called species. So they have for example, we can say human beings. We have different human beings with more similarities. Like for example, we have Africans, we have Indians, we have whites, we have Chinese. Let me give you an example. For example, dogs. You can see these are all dogs. but they have similar characteristics, but they have some differences that are very notable. So this is what we call species, dog species. So individuals with most similarities are called, we name them as species, that grouping. So this is a dog species. So you can see they are all dogs, but they are different, but they are similar. So that's how you answer that question. This is question number two. Name the characteristics of living organism shown by each of the following: budding in east, enlargement of eye pupil in dim right. So you are supposed to answer those two, A and B, and you get your 10 marks. So let's see how you answer that. Question number two. Name the characteristics of living organisms shown by each of the following: A, budding in east, and B, enlargement of eye pupil in dim light. So this question, we can start with part A, budding in east. This is where there is reproduction with only one parent. That is, there is no sexual or fertilization taking place. So what happens is that one cell of the yeast divide itself to reproduce, and we call this asexual reproduction. You can see here we have the nucleus. This is the yeast, this is the parent yeast. So it starts forming the band. Finally, it will form another band, which we call cytoplasm. Plasm divides, so we have bud with nucleus, so it will divide. So we have now other yeast nucleus produced. So this we call asexual reproduction. So that is a characteristic shown by the banding in yeast. The other one is enlargement of eye pupil in dim light. So when you get into a dark room, then your pupil adjust. So we call this, we can say this, the characteristics is we can use the word irritability. We can also say response to stimulus, because the eye is responding to the dark to and adjust itself. So we can say, also use the word, you can also answer it as response to stimulus, the dark room is what we call the stimulus, that is the darkness. Or you can say, you can use the word sensitivity. You can all use the word sensitivity, that enlargement of eye pupil when you get from lighted place to a dim right place. So that's how you answer that question, and you get yourself 2 marks. This is question number three. You are told to explain why there is no grass in most dense forest, and you get 2 marks. So I'm going to show you how you answer that question and get these 2 marks. Question number three. Explain why there is no grass in most dense forest. So you can answer this. Dense forest, the trees form a kind of a canopy or shadow, which prevent the light from reaching the ground. Thus, the grass die or cannot grow because no photosynthesis can take place. So you can answer it like this. You can say the trees form canopies. or we can say shadow, or you can use the word shade, which prevent light, prevent light from reaching grass. Not that one, from reaching grass. So we can say the grass die or you can say die or fail to flourish due to its inability to photosynthesis. So that's how you answer that question. So you can simply say that the trees form a shadow that prevent light from reaching grass, and therefore, since there is no, the grass cannot grow where there is no photosynthesis, where in photosynthesis light is required or sunlight. This is question number 4, and you are told one of the structural difference between a cell wall and a cell membrane. So you state, so I've given you a cell here, labeled cell. So you, let's see how we answer this question to be able to get that mark. This is question number 4, and we are told state one structural difference between a cell wall and a cell membrane. So there are several differences structural. One is that the cell wall is fully permeable, while the cell membrane is semi-permeable. That's one. The other one is the cell wall is mainly made up of cellulose, that is fiber, while cell membrane has double protein layer sandwiching the lipid layer. The other one is cell wall is rigid, tougher, that is, it does not burst easily, while cell membrane is weaker, it can burst. Maybe we have a look at a picture of a cell, and we'll concentrate mainly on the cell wall and the cell membrane. So you can see this is the cell wall, the cell membrane, and this is the cell wall, or the green part. The yellow part is a cell membrane, the green part is a cell wall. So you can answer this question like this. You are required to give one structural difference, but I'm going to give you three. You can, if you write any of them, you'll be able to get that mark. So you can say cell wall is fully permeable. So you can say cell wall is fully permeable. While cell membrane is semi-permeable. This means that the cell wall has larger pores. So you can say cell wall has larger pores. But if you write this, the first sentence is okay. Cell membrane small, that is, let's correct that, small pores. That is why the cell wall is fully permeable, because it has larger pores. This is larger pores. Then we have another structural difference you can mention is that cellular is mainly made up of cellulose. So you can say cellular is mainly made up of cellulose. Cellulose, or you can say fiber, while cell membrane has a double protein layer, cell membrane. As a double protein layer. Sandwiching the lipid layer. Sandwiching. Sandwiching. The lipid layer. So that's another structural difference. The cell wall is mainly made up of cellulose or fiber, while cell membrane has a double protein layer. The other structural difference you can mention is that the cell wall is rigid. Cell wall is rigid. Or you can say tougher compared to cell membrane, weaker, or it can burst. So as you can see, the cell wall here, even the width, the it is stronger than the cell membrane. So if you choose any of these, you should be able to get that mark. You don't necessarily need to show the cell. This one I've just put it there for you to be able to see, and I've only concentrated on the cell wall and the cell membrane. Maybe you can have a look at it and over the other parts and remind yourself of the components of a cell, a plant cell. So that's how you answer that question. Welcome to 2020 KCSC Biology Paper 1. This is question number 5. Let's see how we answer that question. Question number 5. The diagram below shows an organism in a certain kingdom. So we have an organism here, with the label named E. So this is a mushroom. If you look at it closely, you see it's a mushroom. It's a kind of a fungi. So name the part A. Name the kingdom to which the organism belongs. So it belongs to the kingdom of fungi. So you get one mark for answering that. But B, state the mode of nutrition for the organism. The fungus, they feed on dead decaying matter. So you can say feed on dead decaying matter. So which you can also say, you can use the word cerophytism. Cerophytism. Or you can say saprophytic. So that is a mode of nutrition for the fungi. Part C, name the part labeled E. So this part is known as Haifa. Or you, in plural, you can write Haifa. So these are wrong branching filamentous structure of the fungi. You can also describe it, or you can also describe this part as mycelium. Mycelium, or you can still call it rhizoids. All these are acceptable terms. We look at part Roman number 2. State 2 functions of part labeled E. So the one function is it secretes digestive enzyme. Secretes digestive enzymes. For external digestion, you can for external digestion. Digestion. So if you just say secrete digestive enzymes, that's okay. The other function is that it supports the organism or the fungi. And the other function is absorbs nutrients and food from the environment. So those are they have stated 3, but you give 2, that will be okay. You'll be able to get 2 marks. So that is how you answer that question, and you get 1, 2, 3, 5 marks. This is 2020 KCSE Biology, paper 1, question 6. Let's see how we answer that question. Question number 6, state the importance of a well-developed blood capillary network in the alveoli. So first of all, what is an alveoli? Alveoli is a very tiny air sac in your lungs that keep up the oxygen you breathe in and keep your body going. So we can have a look at that. So this is what are alveoli. So this is the lungs. So this is an enlarged part of the alveoli, this part here. So you can see there are very many. So the blood capillary in the alveoli, why is it important, or how does it help? So we can say it increases the surface area, because you can see there are very many. So those small parts, the blood network, the surface area, increases the surface area for efficient exchange of respiratory gases. And what are these respiratory gases? These are oxygen and carbon dioxide. So maybe I can say alveoli is are tiny air sacs. In your lungs, or in the lungs that keep the oxygen you breathe in, and removal of carbon dioxide, carbon 4 dioxide. Anyway, that's not okay what you are supposed to do, but just an explanation of that. So the answer that you should give here, now that you have understood how the alveoli works, is that it increases the surface area for efficient exchange of respiratory gases. That is i.e. oxygen and carbon dioxide. So that is the answer you give, but it is important now you have seen how the alveoli or the blood capillary. So the alveolis are surrounded by blood capillaries that absorb oxygen, and when the oxygen is taken to the heart, the blood brings in the or the carbon dioxide that has been used by the body, and it is removed through the alveoli, and then you breathe it out. So that's how you answer that question, but you only need to answer that. You don't need to explain all that I have put here. Welcome to 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1, question number 7. Let's see how we do that. Question number 7, name the genetic disorder in humans that is characterized by inability of blood to clot. So when you talk of blood clot, it is when you are injured, where the blood is coming out, it forms a solidify kind of, so that it prevents further liquid blood from getting out of your body. So that is clotting. So the disorder that makes the blood not to clot is called hemophilia. Maybe you can explain that more. So hemophilia, this is the red blood cells. So this is a normal cell. So this is a cell that has been injured, which we call hemophage. This is now, the clotting takes place here, so it seals off that section where the blood is coming out. So this is a healthy person. This is a normal blood cell. When it is injured, we say it's a hemophage, and now it is due to that characteristics or that inability of blood to clot, the blood will continue coming out, and that condition is now what we call hemophilia. So the answer that you put here is hemophilia. So I hope you have understood how that occurs using this diagram, and that's how you answer that question. This is 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1, question number 8. Let's see how we go about it. Question number 8. We are told, part A, sketch a graph on the axis below showing how temperature affects the rate of diffusion. So we have our graph here. The y-axis, we have temperature in degrees centigrade. The x-axis, we have the rate of diffusion. Part B, account for the shape of the sketch made in A above. So the increase in temperature increases the rate of diffusion. So that is the graph. So we can explain that using diagrams. So we can here, you can see here we have diagrams. So if you increase here, we have diffusion taking place, the red particles diffusion. But if you increase the temperature, that is increase in temperature, the rate of diffusion will increase, and with time it will be uniform. That is diagram one, D1. The other diagram, when you increase the temperature, it increases the kinetic energy of the molecules. Kinetic energy is the energy of movement, or that the energy as a result that makes something move. So here are molecules. So when you increase the, you can see they are moving, but when you increase the temperature, it increases the kinetic energy, and therefore that increases the rate of diffusion. So that is how. So our graph here, we can say we will draw a graph like that. Increase in temperature increases the rate of diffusion. So the second part, so this is how you answer the first part. You just draw that line. This is just for explanation. Part B, you can say you account the shape of the sketch made in A. So you are explaining this graph. So you say the rate of diffusion, the rate of diffusion increases with increase in temperature. You can also answer it using now the terms of kinetic energy. You say increase in temperature, increase in temperature increases the kinetic energy, increases the kinetic energy increases the kinetic energy of the molecules of the molecules increases the rate of molecules that and this increases and this increases the rate of diffusion. So that is how you answer that question. So this diagram are just for. So so kinetic energy is a energy possessed by a moving body. If you did physics, you understand that. But even if you don't understand more about kinetic energy, you can just say the rate of diffusion increases with increase in temperature, and there you'll still be able to get the mark. This is 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1, question number 8. Let's see how we answer that question. Question number 9, part A. Explain why plants have lower respiratory rates compared to animals. B. State two situations in plant when rate of respiration raises more than normal. So what is respiration? Respiration is a system. The respiration system is a network of organs that help you breathe. So these are the organs that help us breathe. In in human beings or animals, we have airways from the nostrils. Those are the, we have the lungs. We have the blood vessels. So these are the organs in the respiratory system. This is for animals. For plants, what are the organs that help the plant to breathe? One, stomata in leaves. The other one is lenticels. And the root system. We call it root hairs. So that is, you need to know this information. So when you come back to answering the question, the part A, explain why plants have lower respiratory rates compared to animals. The reason here is plants are less active than human beings. Hence, they require lower amount of energy than animals. So the animals move from one place to the other. They do activity like human beings. They do activities, they work and so forth. So the answer here is a plant are less active than humans. And humans hence require lower amount of energy. So that is the reason. Part B, you are supposed to answer like this. State situation when the rate of, for plant, one is during germination. Germination. That is, they require energy is, they require more energy to do that process of germination. The other one is during rapid growth. During rapid, during that rapid growth, there is a lot of cell division, and therefore they require energy for that. And the other one is during active uptake or transport of substance or transport of substance through the roots. We say through the roots. So that is how you answer that question. So if you give those three, if you give any of the two, you should be able to get mark, and then the first one. So but you need to understand what the respiratory system, so that you also understand how to answer this question. So that's how you do that. This is 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1, question number 10. Let's see how it is answered. Question number 10. Explain why most plants growing in waterlogged areas die before attaining maturity, and you get yourself 3 marks. So the reason why the plants die before attaining maturity is lack of aeration. So when we have, when a place is waterlogged, it prevents the air circulation in the soil, and this kills the root. Maybe we can understand it better with the use of diagrams. So this is a waterlogged this is a maize in a waterlogged area. So the root system is covered with water. And this other diagram here explain, you can see here there is exchange of air, so there is oxygen coming in, so the roots are able to absorb oxygen, because you can see there are spaces in between the soil particles. These are spaces in between the soil particles. So the carbon dioxide is able to escape out of the soil. But for this one, this is the root of a water rocked. You can see the air spaces have been covered with water. So there is no circulation of water. This is a flooded area, and therefore exchange of there is no oxygen getting into the root system, and therefore the roots will die. So that's just for explanation. So your answer should be, you can say lack of aeration, which we can say water logging expels air from the soil, resulting in saturation condition. The roots degenerate and the crop can die. The root So that's how you answer that question, and I hope you have understood using these diagrams. So this is a root system underneath this rocked maize, and you can see now the difference between a well-drained soil and a flooded area. So that's how you answer that question. This is 2020 KCSE Biology, paper 1, question number 11. Let's answer that. Question number 11. The diagram below shows a plan of a pedipalp limb. So we have humerus, we have L, K, thumb. Name the bones labeled K and L. So before we go to that, we need to know what is a pedactyl rib. A pedactyl rib is a rib with 5 digits. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like your hand, like the human hand and foot. We have 4 digits. We have the thumb and four fingers. So let's have a look at the diagram before we go to answering the question. So here we have examples of pedactyl limb. So this is for human, that is for human, this is for a horse, this is for a cat, this is for a bat, this is for a bird, and this is for a whale. And this diagram, you can also have a look at it, the way we label our pedactyl limb. From the shoulder here, we have the clavicle, we have the right scapula, we have humerus, we have the radius, we have ulna, we have the thumb, we have carpels, we have metacarpels, and pharynges. So with that now, this is also a different type of pedactyl limb. So we can now come to answer the question. Looking at this, name the Name the bones labeled K and L. So K is the ulna. K is the ulna. And L is the radius. So those are the two answers that are needed here. And now you understand what is a pedactyle limb and examples of them. And you can also look at this. Maybe in the next question, you may be required to label a pedactyle limb. So that's how you answer that question. This is 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1, question number 12. Let's see how we answer that. Question number 12. With reference to germination, explain the meaning A. The meaning of the term is imbibition, but B, why the dry mass of the endosperm decreases while that of the embryo increases. So, the meaning of the, in terms of germination, the meaning of the word, of the term imbibition, is absorption of water by seed when it is germinating. We can say through the microfiber or the seed coat. Part B, why the dry mass of the endosperm decreases while that of embryo increases. So, this is because during germination, the stored food in the endosperm is broken down or hydrolyzed. Can I explain that a little bit using a diagram? So here we have a diagram, a simple experiment. If you put seeds in a beaker and you put water, you give it some time, you find that the water will be absorbed by the seed, and the seed will swell as the seeds prepare to germinate. So that is a simple experiment that can be used to explain that. So to answer this question now, regarding to that, you can write, this is absorption of, that is, this is absorption of water by, this is the germination, or during germination, by seed. You can say through, the microfiber. Let's correct that. That's not the spelling. Microfiber, or you can say seed coat. So that is how you should answer that. Or you can absorption of water by seed through microfiber or seed coat. So that is, you get 1 mark. The second part, why the dry mass of the endosperm decreases while that of the embryo. So this is the embryo here. You can see here, this is the endosperm, this is embryo. So when the seed start germinating, you can see the endosperm start getting smaller. This is the embryo when it start growing, because it is used using the food in the endosperm. So that is why it decreases and the embryo increases. That you can see the plant is growing. So here you can see during germination, food stored in the endosperm is broken down. That is down, which in another word we call it hydrolyzed. So that is how you answer that question, and I hope that diagram enables you to, it's a simple experiment, you can even do it at home have helped you to understand this question, why the dry mass of the endosperm decreases while that of the embryo increases, and there you get two marks, and also the meaning of the word imbibition. It is absorption of water by seed through microfil, or you can say seed coat. That is how you answer that question. This is question number 13, 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1. Let's see how we answer that. Question number 13. State two characteristic features used to classify members of class Coniferales. So this word Coniferales comes from the word canvas, like canfa wood. So it's a canvas are a group of trees and shrubs, e.g. pine trees and fir trees that grow in cooler areas of the world. They have fruits called cones and very thin leaves called needles, which they do not normally lose in winter. To understand more, let's have some diagrams to show that. So these are conifers. This is one. So we are saying they have thin leaves. You can see thin leaves. You can see them along Naivasha Road, where there is a forest there. This is another species of conifer, and this is another species. So we say they have thin leaves. You can see all of them, the three of them, they have thin leaves. You can see their seeds. Their seeds, we have said, they have cones. These are cones here. So those are the conifers trees, or conifers group of trees, species of trees. So they normally grow in cold areas of the world, and during winter, like other trees which have broader leaves, they don't lose their leaves. So to answer the question, state two characteristics used to classify members of the class Coniferales, which I have said is from the word conifers. So the two characteristics, we can name one: presence of cones, which I have shown. These are the cones, that is one characteristic. The other characteristic is that they have naked seeds, which you can also say seed not are not enclosed. Their seeds are not enclosed. Then we can add another one. We can say exorophytic characteristics. This means needle-like leaves, which means needle-like leaves. You have seen the leaves here. They are needle-like. They have thick waxy cuticle. So those are three characteristics. If you name any two of them, which you can, like the first two, they are very clear. Presence of cones, you can see cones. Needle-like seeds, that is naked seeds. That is, their seeds are not covered with the content like where we have mangoes or oranges. So that is how you answer that question. I hope you have followed. Let's go to the next question. This is number 14, 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1.
Let's see how we answer that question. Question number 14. The graph below represents a growth curve in a certain phylum. So we have the graph, y-axis representing mass in kilograms, x-axis representing time in days. So we can say it takes around 25 days at 20 kg. We have around takes around 25 days. So from there to 35 days, it gains 40 kg like that. Name the type of growth curve shown. You get 1 mark. And here, name the phylum where members show the type of growth curve illustrated. So this type of growth is known as staircase or intermittent. And the other one, the type of members, this has andropoda. And these are invertebrate animals such as insects that have sedimented bodies and jointed ribs. So we can use a diagram to illustrate that. So this is a diagram here showing us the andropoda. So you can have these grasshoppers, these are the ants, these are the fry. I think these look like cockroach, spider, and so on. So this is a type that we refer to as andropoda. So to answer this question, now you understand the andropoda. What are the andropoda? These are invertebrates, animals such as insects that have segmented bodies and jointed ribs. So you can see segmented. You have the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. This one. So you can answer. You answer this question. You can say name the type of growth curve shown. You have seen that it looks like a stair. So it the mass increases, takes some time, a constant, then it increases constant, like the way we describe the stairs. So we can say this type of growth curve is known as it is called intermittent. Or we can say staircase growth curve. The second part of the question, we are told name the phylum where members show the type of growth curve illustrated. So I have said these are the andropoda. Andropoda, and I've given you examples of andropoda. They are invertebrates like insects that have segmented bodies and jointed ribs. So that is how you answer that question. This is number 15, 2020 KCSE Biology Paper 1. Let's see how you answer that question. Question number 15, part A. State two limitations of fossil records in tracing evolutionary history of living organisms. So we can name, we can start with the first one. So we can say missing rings as a result of some parts decomposing. So that is one. So some parts, so you cannot, they completely decompose, so you rack, they are not rats. So the other one is distortion of some parts during sedimentation. We can add another one and say destruction of fossils. Destruction of fossils. Fossils by activities. E.g., can give example, earthquakes, we can have faulting of mass movement of earth surface, faulting mass movement. Mass movement of earth surface. And we can also say volcanicity. So these are geological activities. We have earthquakes, we have movement of the earth surface. The Rift Valley, we have volcanicity. Those are that. So if you name any two of this, you should be able to get 2 marks. Okay, part B, describe cell biology as an evidence of organic evolution. So we can say presence of similar cell organs, presence of similar cell organelles. We have mitochondria, we have ribosomes. Another one is biological chemicals. We can also say in this one, similar biological chemicals. Similar biological chemicals like ATP, proteins, and DNA. The other one we can say similar blood pigmentation. Similar blood segmentation. Pigmentation. In tissues of some group, some groups of animals. phytogenetic origins. So that is a presence of similar cell organs or similar biological chemicals, similar blood pigmentation in tissues of some groups of animals show they have common peak phytogenetic origins. So that's how you answer that question, and there you get 2 marks. And this one you get 3 marks rather, and this one you get 2 marks. So that's how you answer that question. This is question number 16, that is 2020 KCSE biology, paper 1, concerning the menstrual cycle. So let's see how we answer that question. Question number 16. The illustration below shows a summary of the main phases of the human menstrual cycle. So we have the diagram here from, you can say, from menstruation, 7th day follicle phase, 14th day, then 21st day luteal phase, Duty phase, then we have 28 days, the cycle completes. Part A, name the process that take place around the 14th day. Part B, name two hormones produced at the follicle phase. Part C, under which two conditions would the cycle be interrupted. So before we answer the question, let's have a look at the human menstrual cycle and try to understand how it works. So here is a diagram showing the menstrual cycle. So we have from day one, after the previous cycle is complete, we have the menstruation. This is what we call the period time, whereby whatever was prepared in the uterus of the wall to receive the ovum was fertilized, is released to clean up the uterus for another, to prepare for another cycle. So for 7 days approximately there, that's roughly, so some take maybe 5-6 depending, it varies with the individuals. So the other part is called proliferative phase. This is when now the ovary starts preparing the release of the egg to the uterus. So we have ovulation stage. Ovulation stage occurs when the egg is released from the ovary and ready to be fertilized. So we say the green part here is a fertile stage. This is when the sperm meets with the ovum, fertilization takes place or conception. Then after the 15th days onwards, this you sometimes you give allowance here, then if there is no fertilization taking place, then the body start or the uterus start to prepare the release of that ovum, and that is what we call secretory phase. Then we are the cycle is repeated. So that is how the menstrual cycle works. So now we can go ahead and answer our question. So here we have now the cycle demonstrated here. Name the process that take place around the 14th days. So you see here we have the 14th day is the ovulation. So here ovulation, we have said, is part of the menstrual cycle that occurs when an egg is released from the ovum. So here you are supposed to answer ovulation. Ovulation, and you get 1 mark. Okay, part B, name two hormones produced at follicular phase. We have seen the follicular phase. This is the follicular space is here, around here. So to answer that, we say the one hormone that is released is follicle stimulating hormone. Which we also call FSH, but you don't like the in short in an exam, you will not be able to get that mark. So that is a follicle stimulating hormone. The work of this hormone, it helps to control the menstrual cycle and stimulate the growth of egg in the ovaries, the growth of egg in the ovaries. Then the other one is estrogen. Or we can also estrogen. So the work of the estrogen, like I've said, is occurs when the egg is released from the ovary, and this help in the development of the egg. Okay, so we have those are two. We can have another one. Another one is luteinizing hormone.
luteinizing hormone. This hormone stimulates egg release. It stimulates the egg release. That is what we call ovulation. It stimulates the release of the egg. Part C of the question, under which two conditions would the cycle be interrupted? This is when some conditions would make would interrupt the cycle, and one of them is sickness. So if a person is sick, it may interrupt the menstrual cycle. The other condition is a drastic change of weather. Change of weather or environment. So we can have a drastic change, sudden change of weather. For example, it becomes too cold, and this may also interrupt with the menstrual cycle. The other one, those are two. You can have others, pregnancy. We can have pregnancy. We can also implantation, or we can say conception. Conception. So pregnancy. When a woman gets pregnancy, then it means that the menstrual cycle will not complete. Because now the womb, the uterus had prepared for the baby or the embryo, and it will start developing. So that means that it has interrupted. Implantation is when we have sperms introduced to the womb, and fertilization take place. Similarly, conception is when we have the normal intercourse and fertilization take place. So that is another condition. Another one is emotional instability. Emotional instability. Instability. And what do we mean here? We mean, for example, when your one has anger or is angry, that can interfere with the menstrual cycle. We also have stress. When one is stressed, can interfere with the menstrual cycle. Anxiety. So those conditions, that is, are the ones that we are referring to as emotional instability. So that is how you answer that question. I hope you have understand. It is important you understand the menstrual cycle so that you will be able to answer such kind of a question. This is question number 17, that is 2020, biology paper 1, question number 17. So let's see how you answer that question. Question number 17. State two reasons why blood reaching the glomerulus is always under high pressure and you get 2 marks. So before we answer this question, I think it's better we look at a diagram showing us glomerulus, how it works, so that you can understand how to go about it. So this is a diagram showing us the glomerulus. So we have the afferent artery, and we have bringing in blood to be filtrated, and we have efferent over artery. This is afferent, and this is, so you can say this one is broader. The afferent artery is broader than the efferent artery. So it means that here the blood will come out with high pressure because more is getting in at the heart, and the outer passage is narrower, so that the reason. So Gurumeruri is a small round clusters which you can see here of capillaries. These are capillaries. They are microscopic and are surrounded by double wall capsule. So you can see the double wall capsule, it is called Bowman's capsule. Can see it's shown there. Bowman capsule in turn connects with the long tube. So this is the tube that is connected. The capsule and the capsule and the attached tube are known as nephron. So that is how the glomerulus work or looks like, I think now. So to answer this question now, the way the answer is supposed to be, you can say the renal artery branches directly from aorta. Aorta, whose brand under high pressure, whose brand is under high pressure. So we say afferent afferent artery supplying blood is broader than efferent. Taking out blood. So I hope you have understood. So that is how you answer that question and you get yourself 2 marks. This is question number 18, 2020 KCSE biology paper 1. It involves a blood test where sugar was detected. So let's see how we answer that question. Question number 18. During a clinical laboratory test, some sugar was detected in an individual sample of urine. Name A, the hormone that was insufficient in the patient. Part B, the gland that produces the hormone named in A above. C, the disease the individual was to be suffering from. So before we start answering that question, I always like to use a diagram to explain some. So let's see here, the hormone that is the deficient is insulin. So where do we get insulin from? The following diagram will help us to understand that. So this diagram of a human being. So this is where we have our pancreas. This is the pancreas. The pancreas is the one, it is located in the abdomen. This is the abdomen. The work of the insulin, the pancreas, it convert food we eat into fuel for the body cells. Okay, so we have other parts here. Of course, we have the esophagus here. Here we have the liver. You can see the liver here. We have the stomach here. We have the small intestines. This is the bile duct underneath the liver. This one, the green part there.
And we have the bile duct. Actually, this is the gallbladder. The bile duct is that pipe that produces or transfers the bile from the gallbladder. So that is what it means. The pancreas has two functions. One, it is we say we can just put it here, exocrine. This exocrine function, it help in digestion. This is a digestion. That is one work of the insulin. It help in digestion. The other one is endocrine. This one, it helps to regulate blood sugar. Blood sugar. So exocrine help in digestion. Endocrine help in regulation of the blood sugar. And this is now is what our question is concerned about. So with that knowledge now, let's answer our question. Okay, so I have said the hormone that is when sugar was detected in a sample of urine, the hormone that was deficient was insulin. So the answer to that part A is insulin. The gland that produces the hormone is named above. We have said that the pancreas is the one that produces the insulin. Pancreas gland. So that you get 1 mark. See the disease the individual was likely to be suffering from. The disease is diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus is a type of diabetes when there is too much sugar in the blood. There is high blood glucose. So that is when you are said to be suffering from diabetes mellitus. So that is how you answer that question. I hope you have understood and a very important concept, the pancreas. If you feel normally nowadays it brings a lot of problems to people, and the diabetes is a very serious disease. This is question number 19, 2020, KCSE Biology Paper 1. Let's see how we answer this question. The graph below illustrates the effect of pH on certain protein digesting enzymes, SN2. So we have a rate of substance breakdown. So we have enzyme S. Enzyme S is this is a pH value, is operating in an acidic environment. T is operating in an alkaline environment. So this side is acidic, this side is alkaline or basic. So A, name the enzymes S and T. We can say S is pepsin. And what is pepsin? Pepsin is a stomach enzyme that serves to digest protein found in ingested food. So it helps in digestion of proteins of the food that's taken in. What about T? T is trypsin. Trypsin is an enzyme that aid in digestion, and it is found in
in the small intestine. It helps in digestion and it is found in the small intestine. B, Roman number one. Name the part of alimentary canal where enzyme T is likely to be found. This enzyme T, that is trypsin, is found in duodenum. Okay, it is found in the duodenum. Roman number two. Explain your answer in B above. So in the duodenum, the medium is alkaline, so the or basic, so you can say in the duodenum, the medium is alkaline. We have basic. Vivarin optimo working on. Vivarin optimo work. Optimo working of the enzyme. T. So that is how you answer that question, and you get yourself here you get 1, 2, 3 that is 5 marks in this question. This is question number 20, KCSE 2020 biology paper 1. Let's see how we answer that question. Question number 20. Explain the biological significance of completing a dose of antibiotics. So antibiotics are used to eliminate pathogens. So let's use some diagrams to understand this better. So this is a sample of antibiotics. We call them, when they are packaged like this, we call them capsules. Why are they packaged like this? Because some of them are very bitter, and so they are sealed like this so that you can be able to swallow. Once they get into the stomach, they burst and they are absorbed to the body. Then the thing that also you need to know is, what is a dose? So a dose, we can say a dose is a quantity of medicine. A dose is quantity of medicine can put like that, or drug taken, or drug taken or recommended. Recommended to be taken at a particular time. To be taken at a particular time. So you are given a pack of medicine, and you are told maybe take one in the morning, one in the evening. They normally say one times two, or you say 1 times 3, like that. So you are supposed to, and then one capsule in the morning, one in the mid morning, or in the noon, and the other one in the evening. So and then you take maybe for 5 days, so they are counted when you are given that. So with that in mind, now we can look at the question, and how are you supposed to, now that we understand the dose, what is a dose and antibiotics. So the reason why the biological significance is that a dose is supposed to completely killed the pathogens. So to completely killed or contain the pathogens. Since failure to take full dose, accords the pathogen opportunity, accords the pathogens the opportunity to develop resistance if you don't complete, as after taking part of the antibiotics and you stop, the pathogens may mutate. So the pathogens may mutate over time, giving rise to new strains. Finally, the drug become ineffective. So that is how you, that is a biological significance. So it is very important to complete a dose as recommended by the doctor or a medical personnel. That's how you answer that question. This is question number 21. State two reasons why females with Turner's syndrome are infertile. So what answer do you give to get these 2 marks? Let's see that. Question number 21. State two reasons why females with Turner's syndrome are infertile. So the first thing you should know is, understand what is Turner's syndrome. Turner's syndrome is a, you can say Turner's syndrome is a disorder or is a chromosomal disorder in which a female is born with only one X chromosome. So normally, a woman is born with two chromosomes, sex chromosome, X and X. So these are the genes or chromosomes that determine the sex of the child to be born. A man is born with X and Y. So the Y, if you combine X and X, you get a girl. If you combine X and Y, you get a boy. So those are the ones that determine the sex. So that is what we call Turner syndrome.
that the one is born with incomplete sex chromosome. So to answer this question, state two reasons why female Turner syndrome are infertile. One of them is that they lack let's put it properly, they lack ovaries. So that is one reason. So they lack ovaries. Another one, have small uterus. And another one is less number of chromosomes. So that is three reasons, but you are told to state two. So if you put any two of this, you should be able to get two marks. So that's how you answer that question. I hope you have understood what is Turner syndrome. This is question number 22, 2020 KCSE. Biology paper one. It involves a microscope. So the first one is define the term field of view as used in microscopy. So how do you answer this question? Let's find out. Question number 22, define the term field of view as used in microscopy. State two functions of the body tube of a right microscope. Give a reason why it is not advisable to use water in cleaning a microscope. So to help us answer this question, let's have a look at some diagrams. So we have a diagram of a microscope here, labeled, parts of a microscope labeled, and this is a field view. So the field view is the circular area seen on the stage when focusing or viewing through the eyepiece. So this is these are the eyepieces. So what you see here, the circular thing here, is what is called the field view. So that's what you're observing, whatever you are looking on the sides. So that is what we call the view. That is field of view. So with that, maybe we go to the question. So here, define the term field of view as used in microscopy. So you say a circular area seen on stage of a microscope. On stage when focusing or viewing through the eyepiece of a microscope. So that's okay. State two functions of the body tube of a right microscope. So the body tube, we have holds the revolving nose piece. So one function is holds the revolving nose piece. And we can see that. So this is a nose piece, the revolving nose piece, this one here, which you can adjust with different lenses. So it help, that is a function of the body tube. The other one is holds, connect the eyepiece to the objective lens, connects the eyepiece. To the objective lens. So that's another function. So those two are okay. And then we can say it holds the ocular or eyepiece lens in place. And you have seen that this is a objective lens, so it holds that in place. This is a objective lens here. So we go to this part C, holds the ocular eyepiece lens in place. Give a reason why it is not advisable to use water in cleaning a microscope. One is water can cause rusting. So we can say to avoid rusting. To avoid rusting, and we can have another to avoid the interface with not interference with the visibility of the lenses. To avoid interference with visibility let's correct that visibility of the lenses. So that's how you answer that question. I hope you have followed. Let's go to the next question. This is question number 23. KCSE Biology Paper 1. You are told to explain the role of blood capillaries in thermoregulation. So how do you get these 2 marks? Let's find out. Question number 23. Explain the role of blood capillaries in thermoregulation. You get 2 marks. So thermoregulation is a control of temperature in our body. So how are the capillaries involved in this? Let's use the following diagram to explain this concept. So here we have capillaries. Blood capillaries near the skin. So you can see what happens is that this is blood vessel. When the temperature is when the temperature is high, the blood the capillaries dilate or become enlarged, so that more blood passes through. And when it get enlarged, it comes near the skin. So heat is lost through the skin. Heat lost across epidermis. Epidermis is a part of the skin. So that is, you reduce the heat in the body as a result of the heat being lost through the skin. So that is a regulation of heat. The other one, and we call that vasodilation, when the capillaries dilate. The other one is when the temperature is low and the body wants to conserve the energy or body heat. So you see now the capillaries constrict, become narrower and move away from the skin. So it means epidermis. It means there is less heat lost through the skin. So in that way, heat is conserved. And this is called vasoconstriction. So that is a concept behind blood capillaries in thermoregulation. So to answer the question, we can say The blood capillaries near the skin, the blood capillaries near the skin constrict during cold, not like that, during cold or low temperature, and dilate during hot or we can say high temperature. Facilitate heat loss. So that is how you answer that question, and you should be able to get 2 marks. So I hope you have understood this diagram. It clearly shows you how heat is conserved, or body heat is conserved or lost when the temperature is high, when it is hot, and when it is cold. So that's how you answer that kind of a question. This is question number 24, KCSE biology paper 1. So you are told the diagram below shows that the effect of hormones on insect growth and development. So how do you answer the questions that follows? Question number 24. The illustration below shows the effect of hormone on insect growth and development. So we have the diagram here. We have brain. In the brain, we have neurosecretory cells. We have corpus arachnum. So there is a hormone here, K. This is rubber cuticle. Then there is a GRAD L. There is ecdysarm hormone. There is a process M. There is egg, larva, pupa, and adult. So the question is, name the hormone K. So the hormone K here is called juvenile hormone. Juvenile hormone. The juvenile hormone is crucial in metamorphosis of the insect. GRAD L, this is GRAD L, produces ecdysarm hormone. So that GRAD is known as prothoracic GRAD. It regulates molting. Part B, state the role of ecdysarm hormone in the growth and development of the insect. So it causes metamorphosis. Causes metamorphosis. It also causes larva stage. Then larva stage of an insect to change into pupa. And pupa into adult. Part C. Name the process M. This is a process. This is a process M. So, the process M is complete metamorphosis. Complete metamorphosis. Account the rapid increase in size of organism immediately after molting. So the reason is that during molting, you can say during molting, the exoskeleton is shed off, allowing the larvae, to take air, to take in air and water, leading to rapid growth. In turn, and thus increase in size. So that is the how you account it. That's why there is increase in size of the organism immediately after molting. So that is how you answer that question. I hope you have followed. Let's go to the next question. Subscribe to this channel, like and comment, so that you can be able to get more videos of this kind. Hit the alarm button for notification. This is question number 25. We are told complete the table below on the adaptations and functioning of some of the structures in dicotyledonous stem. So how do you answer this question to be able to get the 4 marks? Let's find out. Question number 25. A. Complete the table below on the adaptations of functioning of some structures in a dicotyledonous stem. So we have part cambium, parenchyma. We have adaptation. So for cambium, we say cell have dense. The cell have dense cytoplasm to enable rapid mitotic division. Giving rise to secondary growth. Parenchyma, we say, have thin wall for faster passage. Of materials. Have large irregular shape. For storage. But B, explain why the reef of a Saxiplant has a thick and shiny cuticle. So, thick cuticle, that is the outer covering of the sisal reef, enable it to conserve water. Water loss. Then we say the shiny cuticle reflects light. Reflect light, minimizing loss that is minimizing evaporation through radiation. So that's how you answer that question and you get yourself 4 marks. So let's go to question number 26. This is question number 26 and you are told, explain why an individual with blood group AB can only donate blood to an individual with the same blood group. So let's find out how you answer this question to get 2 marks. Question number 26. Explain why an individual with the blood group AB can only donate blood to an individual with the same blood group. So the individual blood has both antigen A and B. They will coagulate or agglutinate with antibodies A and B found in individual blood group A, B, and O. Okay, so we say the individual individual's blood has both antigens. A and B they will coagulate, or we also say agglutinate, with antibodies. Let's correct that, with antibodies A and B. B found in individuals with O. So that's how you answer that question. Let's go to question number 27. This is the last question, that question number 27. And we are told the diagram below illustrates a set of biological processes in a green plant. So we have the diagram there. So we are supposed to answer those questions that follows. Let's find out how we do that to be able to get this, I think there's 5 marks. So let's do that. Question number 25. We are told the diagram below illustrates a set of biological processes in a green plant. So we have green plant process N, polysaccharide, P, hydrolysis, glucose, anaerobic respiration, compound Q. So question, name process N. This is photosynthesis. Photosynthesis. Roman number two, polysaccharide P, this is starch. This is P, this is N. B, state two conditions necessary for the formation of compound Q. So we have respiratory enzyme. That is one. Two, absence or little oxygen. Part C, state two environmental condition necessary for process N to take place. One, for photosynthesis to take place, we need optimum temperature. That is one. We have two, we have light or sunlight. We have three, water, moisture. Water or moisture. Part four, carbon dioxide. Carbon four dioxide. So those are the necessary conditions for process for photosynthesis to take place. So that brings us to the end of that paper. I hope you have followed what we have covered. You are welcome to view or to check the paper 2 of biology 2020 which is coming soon. So thank you for watching.